Hello, my name is Neil Buchanan with Rock Our World. Welcome to my new studio. I'm out on a job site, and this is our camper. So I kind of thinking this might I might use this quite a bit. I want to refer back to, I've spoken quite a bit about the book Maximize Manhood, and trying to pull a whole lot of thoughts here together. The Christian world has been immersed in the idea that Yeshua or Jesus did away with the law for, several hundred years. The undertaking of the lie of writing the so-called New Testament in Greek, whereas it actually was written in Aramaic and then mistranslated to slant the understanding of what Paul was trying to, and other apostles, but mostly Paul was trying to convey in as a deeper understanding of the Torah, the prophets, and the writings, which are and always will be the scriptures. That's what Paul referred to in 2 Timothy 3:16. He was not referring to his letter in that, I'm quoting from that passage or that part of that inspired commentary. He was referring only to the Torah, the prophets, and the writings. So anyway, going back to this maximize manhood, there's a lot of things, everybody's mind works a little bit differently, but a sharp mind, which all of us have a sharp mind, but maybe in different ways, picks up inconsistencies in teaching. So in Maximize Manhood, I really enjoyed how blunt he was in the majority of the book. But apparently he revised it, this Edwin Lewis Cole, and he added 4 or 5 chapters in the end. And when I got to the end, these last 5 chapters, I could see that he was struggling with this contradiction in Christian theology, where on one hand we say the law is done away with, but on the other hand, Edwin is confronting men with sin. So if you do away with the law, which is actually the Torah is the transgression of the law, so you do away with sin if you do away with law. I was going to say the bathwater and the baby go out together, but that's not quite the right metaphor. Anyway, you did chuck both out, sin and Torah, but we have to have a definition of sin, and God does give it. It's 1 John 3:4. Sin is the transgression of the law, and in fact, referring back to the Hebrew, and Brad Scott will explain this real well. When you analyze the letters of the word Torah, it actually spells out or gives a word picture that means to aim and hit the target. Whereas if you look at the word sin in Hebrew, it has a word picture that says to aim and miss the mark. So in other words, the Torah and sin are opposite to each other. And the only way to define sin is to have knowledge of the Torah. And within the Torah, there's about 600 specific points. And they're all legitimate. They're all enforced. They define moral conduct for human beings. Anyway, here Edwin is a straight shooter in the first, 20 chapters of the book. I forget how many chapters. But these last 4 he added in, there's a lot of good material there. But he's doing what I call Christian calisthenics, calisthenic contortions. Because how do you tell people to quit sinning when the definition of sin is done away with? So Edwin has a real good, strong message, but then he spends a way way too much time trying to explain why you still have to toe the line, even though you don't have to toe the line anymore, so to speak. So anyway, I want to kind of tackle that issue and point that out, because people, you know, I'm recommending this book, and then they start seeing, well, you know, Edwin believes the law is done away with. And, well, Edwin's wrong. But scratch that out, you know, take a pen and put a line through all the places he's explaining why you still have to keep the law even though the law is done away with. And, you know, divide incorrect doctrine from correct doctrine. And that's a challenge. Like, it's paradigms where Christians and Jewish people are going to spend a good bit of time in the next short while, and they're going to go hard because the last days have begun. We're starting to have signs and wonders. We're starting to have a really strong birth pangs of the Messiah, and we don't have a whole lot of time to get our act together. The judgment is beginning at the house of God. God is starting to correct pastors. My wife was given a very powerful message to pass on to a pastor here in town of a huge church, and he's got to get the house he's in care of in order. There's been sin left there for probably decades already and not addressed. And a lot of these things will become a whole lot clearer when you throw away this lie that the law is done away with. Anyway, I got a bit of a humorous look at, and I call it the Torah buffet. And most people are familiar with the buffet idea that there's a long, long table or setup, you know, with all kinds of different foods and anything you can imagine in meats and vegetables and fruits and pizzas and you name it. There are drinks, different kinds of drinks, anything and everything. And let's imagine that this buffet has 600, the Jewish people insist there's 613, but and they could very well be right, but we've looked at a couple of lists and they're different from each other. They just make sure they have 613, but nonetheless, I just say it's about 600. So let's say there's 600 plus items on this buffet table. And I just thought of another thing, that if it was the Jewish buffet table, they would have about 15,000 items on the table, whereas God only put 600 on there. You go to the Christian one, and there's just that 600 and give or take 13. And the only thing is, the Christians were taught, you just go up there and you take what you want. And if you don't like it, leave it, you know. So you go along there, and the people that are bringing the food to the table, you know, they got to keep topping up the things that are going fast, and they got to keep, you know, every day throw away the stuff nobody touches, but put fresh stuff in, you know, so the next day maybe someone will take something. You know what I mean? So, interesting enough, the tithe rule is, they're refreshing that all the time. All the churches teach tithing, even though it's in the law. And there's not too many churches say it's okay to lie or cheat or steal. They get a little iffy when it comes to adultery, because half the people in the seats are divorced and remarried, and maybe two or three times, and there's all this junk going on, lusting after each other, and, you know, looking at the pretty girl two rows up and three over, and all this stuff's going on, and the Lord knows all this stuff's going on, and it's wrong, you know, it is sin. So anyway, back to this buffet, the one on the, you know, eating pigs and all that stuff, and rats, and it's funny, God puts pigs and rats together in one of the scriptures. You should look that up. So if you like pig, well, you got to like rat too, because it's all in the same category. And that is the 614th one for the Christians, because they love that one. You know, they got to eat all that junk, pigs and oysters and shrimps and just a ton of stuff that Jesus Christ showed that we're not to eat that stuff. But anyway, that's not like some huge thing, but it's one of the points of the Torah. So what God's telling us, both the Christians and the Jews, let's just hone this for the Jewish people. Let's hone this back down to 600 and whatever, if there actually is 613. I'll just call 600. I like round figures. So let's hone that back from 15,000 rules for the Jewish people to 600. And for Christians, let's bump it up from about 15 to the 600 that Jesus Christ gave us in the beginning. And I beat that one pretty good. So that's a bit of a humorous look at the Christian buffet. And we got 35,000 denominations, and each one of them has a different definition of sin. And the reason for that is they've been taught, you know, for centuries that the law is done away with. So then it doesn't work very well if everybody just has a free-for-all sin fest. So then they create a list. So that's one of the things that makes denominations different from each other. They create their own customized list of what sin is. And, they come up with all kinds of goofy stuff. And some of it's not even on the buffet. You know, they just made it up. I'll just pick one. I hope I don't offend anybody. But dancing. Let's pick on dancing and cards. There's two. God does not say it's wrong to dance or to play cards. And there'll be some denominations along the way. That's a big one. You know, you don't be dancing and you don't be playing cards. So, you know, it goes from there. There's all kinds of things. You know, alcohol is a tough one, because in reality, God says nowhere that it's wrong to drink alcohol. He does say, however, that it's a sin to become an alcoholic. I think that would be the English equivalent of a drunkard. And it's all about controlling yourself. So the alcohol, the food, like you're not become a glutton. Those are all gifts that God gave us. But when we misuse them, they become a problem. Anyway, I'm going to sign off. I'm going to try and keep these segments short. And see you next time.